Right guys, welcome back. Another video here, Sailing Learning By Doing. It's just me. Yesterday I took Marie to the airport here in Sydney. She flew from Sydney to Singapore, Singapore to Zurich, Zurich to Geneva, and her parents came in the car and picked her up there, and she's home. So the last few days up here in Sydney, we had a good time. Yeah, we sailed around the harbour, which was cool. Marie had obviously never seen Sydney, never been here before. So we cruised around, and it's pretty crazy, you know, as an outsider, that you can just rock up and, you know, just drive past the opera house as close as you want, as long as you keep out of the way of the ferries and things, and you can sort of anchor reasonably wherever you want. Like, it's pretty crazy. It's pretty cool, the access in this city. You can, you know, like, there's massive big warships, frigates, and sort of wannabe aircraft carriers, and you sort of just drive right up to them. It's pretty crazy.
You reckon, babe, I got a special surprise for you today. What do you reckon? You impressed?
I think you don't know how to spell my name.
Yeah, but the pilot probably just did it wrong.
Yeah.
I said Marie and he goes Mary. I'm like Marie, but he couldn't spell French.
So hard.
Yeah. No, he's doing the last part now. That part costs an extra 6,000, but it's really worth it because there's one over here and there's one over here.
We also got invited by one of our patrons over in Manly, John and Denny, and yeah, they're Italian and they've got a beautiful house that they've rebuilt, and yeah, they made pizza for us, but proper pizza. They even have a proper pizza oven, so that was pretty incredible. As you all know, hopefully, Marie's favorite food is pizza basically, so yeah, that was pretty incredible. Thanks you guys, that was really, really nice evening out. We got to have a shower and do some laundry there as well, so that was pretty cool. So yeah, now, I think I did say in the last video there would only be sailing from now on. Well, that's obviously turned out to be a bit of a lie because I'm not sailing right now. I'm waiting for crew to arrive to start heading north. But there is one big job still to do on this boat, and today I'm going to rock you through that one. All right, so you see I'm wearing this hat, GME. This is a proud Australian company who've stepped up to the plate and sent me a bunch of gear to keep us more safe. These things, these are called MOBs, Man Overboard AIS. So they differ from the general PLBs, where PLB is a location device, basically like an EPIRB. So you set it off, or it sets itself off. Some, you know, you can have water immersion ones, and it'll send a signal up to the heavens and back again, and then someone will hopefully see that pretty fast, and then, you know, it'll go through a bit of a chain of command, and they'll contact the next of kin that you've listed and ask if this person is really probably in trouble, and then it'll go down, and then hopefully they'll send a boat out or a helicopter or something and come and locate you and rescue you. Can take a few hours though, you know, just because it has to go through a few different sets of people and depending which country you're in and all that sort of thing. So the thing with these is, there you go, zoom in on that. These are AIS, and basically the idea is that if you fell off this boat and I've got AIS, I can come and find the person. So instead of looking for a coconut-sized head in the water, I'm looking on the screen and the contact is actually coming up as a blinking light. This is the person here. And that's what that is. And so, yeah, if you're a solo sailor, obviously that's not going to really help you because no one's going to come and find you. But for crew on board, this is the thing. It clips on your life jacket here. Got a little tether as well. So basically just pull this off. And it'll set it off, and it's got an integrated GPS and AIS, and that'll come up on the chart plot of the boat and hopefully just whiz back and pick up whoever fell in the water. In order for this to work though, you need to have AIS on your boat, and you know, if you're offshore and going to foreign countries, you'll want to have AIS anyway. GME, thanks for sending me these, but they would be completely useless without one of these. So this is the AIS unit that I need to be able to find someone in the water. This is transceiver obviously, and to make it sort of work properly you need one of these. This is the splitter. So AIS works through your VHF. The VHF on the top of your aerial. You can either put a separate aerial up just for the AIS, but most people use a splitter, so you just share that aerial and it runs through this, and you can still use your VHF radio and AIS. And Yeah, as you can see here, bit of a diagram. I probably should read the manual, but I'm just going to give this a crack. I've thought about it now. I've had this for a few days. Thought about it now, and I've figured out a few cables and bits and pieces I need. This is all Raymarine gear to be able to integrate this so that I can overlay it on my plotter, like overlay it over this the Navionics or whatever I'm running on my plotter. You can overlay this and then see contacts as they come up. So yeah, that'll be today's video, installing this. As you guys probably know, I'm not really that adept or much of a fan of this sort of stuff. I'd rather climb the mast and do the rigging and things like that. Like, all this sort of electronic stuff already makes me a bit like, yeah, you know, I'm just going to probably mess it up and then blow a few foozers and just, you know, zap myself a few times, make my hair stand up. See, it's already standing up. Anyway, I'll do the best I can. It can't be that hard. All right, so I'm going to be installing this stuff down here in the nav station. There's a few ins and outs, so probably I'm not going to go into too many details about this, obviously. As you guys know, I'm not really making top quality videos about, you know, doing projects. I just want to do sailing and adventures, but I'll show you what I'm doing, basically. So this unit has an integrated GPS. You can get a cable and put a puck outside somewhere, but it does seem to go quite good through fiberglass, because I had this exact same unit on Shehalien. That's why I rang up GME and asked if they'd want to supply me with new stuff, because I knew it was great. So I'm just going to be putting that down here, and satellite actually goes quite good through fiberglass, so even though I'm under two layers of fiberglass here, it will probably get enough satellites to work fine without having to run a separate thing. But anyway, what I'm going to do is jury rig this, basically. Just put all the cables together and the power on it and hook it up to the chart plotter just here on the desk and make sure that it all works. And also I have to program in my MMSI number. I'll show you how to do that. There's a software that you put on my laptop. And so I'll hook it up to that, and it's got to be powered, and it's all, you know, I'm just going to not attach anything, basically. I'm just going to make this big mess of wires, but make sure everything works and I can see it on my plotter. And then I'll screw it all on the walls and all that, and run the cables nice and all that sort of thing. But anyway, I'm going to get into it. Okay, we've got it open. This is VHF. This will be where the cable comes to. And this is where I'm going to start. This is the aerial that goes up the mast, and this is the splitter box. So technically, if you have a good VHF aerial on the top of the mast, you should get about a 20 mile range with this. Well, that's what I had on Shehalien. I could see boats 20 miles out, as long as the connections are all good. Okay, that's connected to the aerial. So it's just a pretty easy, I don't know if that'll focus, pretty easy diagram of all the cables that have to go together. And as long as you have all the right cables, and I mean, most of them come with the units, and the difference is the stuff that GME doesn't supply is the interface with your chart plotter system. So, you know, Raymarine, BNG, Garmin, whoever else, they've got different systems. Raymarine uses a C-Talk backbone, so basically you have to be able to see this is a NMEA 2000 to C-Talk converter, and then you've just got to be able to run it to your chart plotter. But yeah, horrendously expensive, bloody Raymarine. This, look at this little thing. This is basically just a T, about 3 cents worth of plastic, $35. This cable, 5 meters, $75. This converter, this little thing, $65. As I said, it's about 30 cents worth of plastic. But it's proprietary. That's why Raymarine, they're the only one who makes it. They get to put their price on it. Thanks, Raymarine. Hopefully you'll come on board one day as a sponsor and I'll back you. Anyway, onwards and upwards. So next we have splitter to A.I.S. transceiver. So this one must be one of these cables. That simple screw on and goes into there. NMEA 2000 go goes in here. Joiner to VHF. So this one goes from the splitter to the back of the VHF, and that's what means you can continue using your VHF radio. It's obviously very important. Because the problem is, I mean, you can run a separate VHF aerial just for the AIS, but you're not going to run a whole new cable up to the top of the mast, or there'd be no point. And then if you just put it on the back of the, say, for example, the solar arch or something, it would work. It would work fine, but you'd only get about a 5 mile range because it's not high enough. VHF's got to be line of sight, so the higher you are, obviously, the further you see. Using the splitter means you get to use the aerial that's already at the highest point on the boat. So basically now I just need to power it up. And that is these two cables, black and red. That'll put power to this. Oh, I also need power to this. Okay. I've got power cables from both units, and I'm just being Mr. Bodgy right now, but I'll probably do this better later, we'll see. I'm just putting these little clamps on there right now. This is a 12 volt cigarette lighter outlet right there. So we've obviously got power there. So I'm just hooking these onto here. And there we go, look at that. We've got lights flashing. But what I can do now that there's power is plug this USB cable into my computer, running the software, and then I'll be able to diagnose how many satellites it's seeing and put in my MMSI number. So I think I'm going to do that next. Okay, hooking this into my little dongle here. So you're looking over my shoulder, come and have a look at this. There we go, this is the software. And so this is all connected now to these two units. And yeah, obviously I have gone and done this beforehand, as you can see. But up here you put in put in your ship's name, your call sign, and important is the MMSI number that you put in correctly, because if you put it in incorrectly, it's very difficult, if not impossible, to change it. So AMSA sent me my MMSI number once I'd applied, and I just copy-pasted it, and then that way I can't really get it wrong. But I did check it two or three times before I pushed enter. So this is right now showing me the satellite hookups as the unit is here sitting on the desk. And as you see, going through two layers of fiberglass, I got plenty of satellites. So basically my unit is transmitting right now my location, and I can see all of these other vessels, their location, their boat names, and you can see where they're going, their class, whether they're commercial or not, and the course and the speed and all this sort of stuff. Everything's looking good. I now have to hook all this stuff up to the chart plotter so that I can see all this data on overlaid on my maps, and that's what's really important, because I don't want to open my laptop every time to see all this stuff. Okay, so I've hooked up the cable to all this crap, and I've just run it through here, out the door, and this is the whole backbone of the Raymarine Sea Talk system, and I've hooked it into a spare one there. Okay, it's the moment of truth. I know it all works downstairs. The important thing is it going to show me all the contacts on the plotter? Because that's what I need to know when I'm sailing. Is there a ship coming straight towards me, or the alarm that I put around me, the safe alarm, and I'm having a sleep if I'm sailing by myself, is any contact coming inside that circle and it's going to beep and wake me up? So right, I'll show you this. Up here. And yes, all of these contacts are AIS contacts. And here, it's actually coming up on this screen and warning me there's a dangerous one. Get rid of that. Okay, so these are all AIS contacts. Now if I click on one of them, that's the dangerous one. Yeah, there it is, that's this detail. It's called Hilsea Pleasure Craft. It's not moving. And if I'm zooming out, Sydney Harbour, I'm even getting contacts. Look at all these contacts here. Even down here in Botany Bay, I'm getting contacts. That's amazing. Wow, I'm stoked. That's just plug and play. But now I'm going to have to figure out the alarm system though, because it's beeping all the time and pissing me off. Can't believe how fast that was. That's a really, really good system at just plug and play. That's for me, the person, the idiot who doesn't like electronic stuff, that is what you want to have. Just plug it in. So basically now I know it all works. I know it's sending correctly the right data. I'm going to check on marine traffic soon and see if it's on there. But now I'm just going to go ahead and, well, basically unplug everything again and mount all the two boxes where I want them, and then plug everything and run the cables in a nice way that you can't see them. This long 5 meter cable that I plugged into the backbone, I'm going to have to put that through the conduit. That's probably going to be a bit of a mission, but we'll figure that out. And I probably won't show you too much of that because it's pretty boring. Anyway, I'll get back to you at the end with the whole end result. Well, I'm super stoked. Okay, big progress. We're nearly finished with this job. I've mounted the unit itself here in the corner. We've run all the cables through underneath. The 5 meter cable I bought was long enough by this much, so pretty much perfection. This box here, this is the splitter. The VHF cable comes right to there, like just there. I can't really mount that. I would have liked to mount it next to that, but I can't really. So I'm just gonna put this in here, just like that. These are like extra wires. These are, this is the USB, and these are extra wires. I'm just gonna roll these up and just zip tie them in a roll and poke them down behind the unit. It's pretty ugly behind there, but look at that. It's all beautiful. Once you close the box, beautiful. So, pretty much done with this job. And yeah, stoked how easy it was. Really, really, I don't know, it's the sort of thing I get nervous about. Like, oh shit, I've got to do that today, and I'm putting it off. But because we are heading north really in the next couple of days, that was really a last minute job that I needed to get done. And yeah, it seems like it's done. So if you guys want to follow us along as we're going north on marine traffic or vessel finder or any of these things, you can actually track us and stalk us. Now, you can track us and see where we are and see what speed we're going, all that sort of thing. I think it probably updates every hour, so it's not completely live, but basically you can see when we're anchored here and there and when we're out sailing, the speed we're doing. And I think you can even see the track we've done and things like that. So if you go into either of those two apps on a website or on your phone, vessel finder or marine traffic, and put in trade runner or the MMSI number, which I'll put up here on the screen, then it should it should find us. You can see where we're going, and if you see us heading towards your town, well then give us a sing out, come down and have a beer. Right guys, that's the end of that video. Sorry, it was a bit of a dry technical one, and I can pretty much say with full guarantees and 100%-ness that from now on there will be just sailing videos for the next few weeks. I don't think there's any more jobs to do. I hope not. And if there is, I won't show you them because you're definitely bored after this. But anyway, very, very good big step getting this security-wise. Boat feels much better. I'm going to be feeling way safer doing night passages especially. Got to give a big shout out to GME. Australians, support your local companies. Pretty important. And they make great gear. Really, really happy with you guys to jump on board, literally, with this upgrade. And we'll be using it for years to come. Also, got to say a massive shout out to all of our patrons. Obviously, makes all this possible. It makes these videos, the time and effort putting into filming them. Obviously, wouldn't be doing that without the support of you guys. So really cool. I managed to meet up with quite a few of you. Well, the odd one or two here in Sydney, which is really cool. Good to put faces to names and things like that and be able to spend some time and get to know you guys in person. Really cool. Obviously, Maria's gone now. You're not going to see her pretty face for a while. She might throw a few clips in every now and again from her time in France. But the next four to six months will go pretty quick and she'll be back aboard with a smiling, well, more likely screaming, farting little bundle of joy. Anyway, we'll see you next week. Bye-bye.